coming together for the last at least two or three years. There's a lot of people involved in this, and we've seen bits and pieces of it come across as each component gets done. So we've seen all the little pieces, but we haven't seen it all put together. So I guess we're going to get the whole enchilada tonight. So enjoy it.
Okay, thanks, John, and welcome to everybody.
Thank you.
I'm Fran Baldwin. I've been working with many of you on Keep Farming Northampton, and we're here tonight to present our cumulative report of work that has been done over a very broad area and several years. Some of you are here for the first time tonight, and we'll try to say some things as we go along to bring you up to speed on what we've been doing. Others of you have seen pieces of the work as we've gone along, and we'll have some new materials for you tonight as well. I'm going to try to move at a crisp pace, that's why I'm using notes, so that there can be ample time for questions and discussion at the end. And we're asking that you hold off your questions and comments until the end, unless there's something you just don't understand on one of the slides. The overall purpose has been to strengthen Northampton agriculture in ways that are good for farmers, good for businesses, and good for the community. More specifically, to support local agriculture, to look for ways that are both desirable and doable, to make farming more secure, more profitable, maybe even more enjoyable. Secondly, to evaluate the strengths and weaknesses of the Northampton food system, to try to look at who the farmers are, what are they growing, where are they selling it, who's buying it, how does it get to market, all those pieces of a food system. We try to do some evaluation. Thirdly, to bridge relationships within the food system, relationships between producers, distributors, consumers, government, businesses, and finally to suggest ways to strengthen the roles of local agriculture and local food as foundations of economic development, sustainability, and community values of access and participation. Participants in this project have been many. These are the five major categories of participants. And what I want to do now is to acknowledge and thank all of these people while at the same time giving you a little history of the work that we've done. So first of all, the Glenwood Center. This project would not have happened without the Glenwood Center and its program, Keep Farming. Keep Farming is a model program for assessing local food systems based on systematic information collected on the ground. Their model provided us with sample surveys that we could change and modify to meet our own needs, and also a path forward. Virginia Kosinski approached us initially to propose that we bring the program to Northampton, and the group of us mounted a public meeting where we found a lot of enthusiasm for moving forward. Since that time, we've had wonderful support from Virginia and from Glenwood liaisons, Andrea Burns and Melissa Adams. And we'd like for those of you who are here, Virginia, Melissa, I think Melissa is here, please stand up and let us thank you. There are going to be a lot of people to thank. So how about if we go through all this and then you thank them all at the end?
We did.
The second group is the Northampton Keep Farming Working Group, a number of people that you see here who have worked in many ways on this project. We had survey researchers and statisticians. We had writers and graphic designers and computer wizards and farmers and activists and people of all trades, and we'd like for you to all stand up and get thanked. Mm-hmm. Agricultural Commission. Right after our initial meeting with Glenwood, the Northampton Agricultural Commission agreed to sponsor the project. This was very important for us, and they, along with Wayne Fiden, the Director of Sustainability and Development, have been consistent in their level of support throughout the project, and we won't make you stand, but we want to thank you. Next, we have Smith, and also the Board of Health, Ben Wood, helped us out this year. Next is Smith College. We learned early in the process that Smith College could be an outstanding partner in our work. The Smith Center for Community Collaboration provided basically all of the financial support for this project. And the Center for the Environment, Ecological Design, and Sustainability, otherwise known as CEDES, mounted a program on local food that we could tap into. In addition to the faculty members listed here and the students, special studies and intern students, I particularly want to recognize the students in the SEEDS Sustainable Food Capstone course. These 10 students who are here tonight have been working so hard over this past semester as kind of one giant mind to move the project forward. They took all of our research, they pulled it together, they did extra research of their own, and they are going to be major participants in this program tonight. So I hope you all please stand and be acknowledged. And finally, I want to thank some of the other organizations and people who have contributed in some way or another to this project. CESA, I see that Phil Corman is here, Road Food Northampton, and others that you can see here. I don't know that we've got everybody because it's been a lot of folks, but we're deeply grateful to everybody. And now, at the end of all this, will all of you who've been involved in this stand up and let us clap for you? In keeping with the Glenwood model, we wanted to collect information on major components of the Northampton food system. So to do this, we designed and conducted four major surveys. First was a survey on farms and farming, also called agricultural economics, in which we interviewed 26 farmers about what they grow, where it is sold, and what issues they face in today's economic climate. Second was a survey of Northampton consumers. We surveyed 550 residents, attempting to select a sample of the population based on the 2010 Northampton demographic profile. We did a pretty good job of matching the profile, although it wasn't perfect, but we got a lot of very good and interesting data out of that project. We asked about people's buying habits and priorities for putting local food on their tables. Third was a survey of Northampton restaurants. We contacted 72 restaurants, believe that, 72 restaurants in Northampton, and discovered right up front that about half of them, notably a group of fast food restaurants, not only do not serve local food, but are prevented by their corporate headquarters from even discussing the sources of their food with us. We were able, however, to survey 38 restaurants regarding the place of local food on their menus and the issues they face in serving it. Reports of all three of these surveys have already been presented to the AgCom, and they exist on the Northampton website, the City of Northampton website, in the Department of Development and Sustainability, but But I'm just going to pass around these paper copies so that you can just look at them if you'd like. We like them back. They're the only ones we have. And you guys have already seen them, so I'll start over here. Fourth and finally, the Smith Capstone students have completed a survey of Northampton institutions. This is new material that none of you have seen and which they will report on tonight. And they too have a paper copy of us of this for us to pass in. In addition to the surveys, the Keep Farming Northampton group and especially the students have used other reports to elaborate on our findings. We looked, for example, at the Northampton Sustainability Plan and the Conway School Food Security Plan. And as the project moved along over the last several years, we recognized increasingly that although Northampton made an excellent case study for local food, a really useful analysis of our local food system requires a regional approach. We needed to learn what was going on beyond our own city limits. So we also acquired information from sources like the Pioneer Valley Planning Commission, the Mass Farm to School Program, and other regional sources. So that's basically the project. And now, I hope you understand what we've done and where we are, and it's time to see some results. So I want to introduce the two students who will lead us through their research and their work in bringing all this material together. These are the Julias. Julia Jones and Julia Whiting.
Yeah, thank you very much, Fran, for that wonderful introduction. Thank you all for being here tonight. We so appreciate your willingness to come out on the end of the week, and we're looking forward to presenting the four surveys that we've been working with. So we'll start out with the farmers that we surveyed. We were able to get in touch with a number of farmers here in Northampton and gathered information, wide range of information on them. So we found out that 82% of those surveyed, these farmers, have been farming for over 25 years. So it's experienced folk that we're dealing with here. 75% said that they were satisfied with their farm operations as is. 30% said they were interested in permanently protecting their land. So regardless of whether or not that they were comfortable with their current production, they wanted to make sure that they conserve their land for generations to come. 60% sold half or more of their produce in Northampton, which is a pretty fantastic number, keeping in mind that that's just the participants in the survey itself. 30% sell some or all of their products at a farmer's market or a farm stand, which is also notable. In order to bring this into context, we decided to look at the land resources that Northampton is pulling on. So we surveyed 26 active farmers that were working with 2,600 acres worth of farmland that's in production, which is 11% of the land in Northampton as a whole. The average size of each farm is 24 acres, and four owners, it's important to remember, own 100 acres or more. So there are a couple of people who are doing quite a lot of farming, quite a big swath of land. If you compare that to the Pioneer Valley and the Pioneer Valley in the context of Massachusetts as a whole, we find that there are nearly 2,000 farms in the Pioneer Valley alone. I remember driving down to Smith and my mom saying, this is the breadbasket. This used to be the breadbasket of Massachusetts and one of the breadbaskets of New England. And that was really powerful for me. And there is a lot of farming going on here. 169,000 acres are in production. That's 14% of the land in the Pioneer Valley. That 33% of the farmland in Massachusetts as a whole, and 25% of the farms in Massachusetts are right here in the valley. The average size is about 50 acres, which is twice as large as the average farm in Northampton. We are right up there. 11% of the land in Northampton is in production, and 14% of the land in the Pioneer Valley as a whole is in production. We believe that there's definitely room for growth there. Then also looking at what's actually being grown here in the municipality, we find that four major crops are in production. So that's potatoes, corn for feed, hay, and soybeans. So that's something that we didn't really expect going into the surveys, but did pop up. It's important to keep in mind that the people who participated, you know, we didn't get to survey everyone, but this is a good representation of what is being grown here. That means that 575 acres are in potatoes, 514 in feed corn, 343 acres for hay, and soybeans are 103. So thinking about the crops to the right here, those are not going directly to human consumption, but rather going through an animal and then to human consumption. And most of these over here are not being consumed here in Northampton for the most part. They're going outside of the municipality. 50% of those, 1,500 acres are in production for these four crops, which represents 50% of the farmland in Northampton, which is considerable. So a big part of these surveys was looking at barriers to local food and producing for the local market. So for farmers, we found that just in general, some of the challenges that they face are the high cost of fuel. That's like the numero uno. Next after that is state and federal regulations, which come up in a number of our other surveys as well. Insurance concerns, as well as theft, trespassing, and vandalism. One person mentioned that they lost considerable amount of money in just one night of someone taking a joyride through their field, which is something that is something really serious to take into consideration as well. Availability and cost of farmland, which is really key here. Property values in Northampton, as we all know, are high, and taxes are high as well. And so this is another issue for people who are looking at selling their farmland or entering into the industry, starting up their own farm. And another part of it is land use laws. So that's another barrier. Finally, marketing and distribution of food. So maybe not the growing of it, but getting it to market and getting it into our homes. So in looking at this whole survey, something that we pulled away is that Northampton is in the center of an active farming community, rich with natural resources. So we have this incredible, river bottom soil that's fantastic, and we have a lot of farming going on here, and that's something we'd like to connect with. So,
all right, now we're gonna take a brief look at the consumer survey. And we're gonna start off with a profile of the Northampton consumer who is most likely to go out of their way to buy local food. We went through it and we thought, all right, who's really going out of their way for this? And the top groups are women over 50, college graduate women, and households with incomes over $75,000 a year. There's a lot of overlap as well between these. So women over 50 with a college degree, who also have a great household income.
I used to
have
college.
So college is here. And looking at where are Northamptonites buying their food, 75% reported buying at least some of their food from supermarkets. Not a complete surprise. 22% reported buying at least some of their food from large retailers such as Walmart. 42% reported going to farmers markets, which is great. That's almost half. And 32% reported participating in CSAs, which is another fantastic statistic.
It's important to keep those in mind that this is just the respondents to our survey, and not all of the residents of Northampton, but it does give you a really cool look at the buying habits of people here in the community.
So now taking a look at interest, 68% of respondents, again, buy local every week. 88% always or sometimes check to see if their food is local. 58% go out of their way to get local food in the growing season, and again, 42% shop at farmers market, which means there's already a huge effort among certain segments of the population to make sure local food is bought and is cooked with. And we looked at reasons for purchasing local food, and some of the top responses were supporting local farms, which is key. The belief that local is fresher and healthier, and that 69% think that buying local helps preserve the environment, quote, a lot. There's a variety of reasons, but supporting local agriculture is at the top, and we, living in a community really cares about its farmers and wants to make sure they're doing all right. So the top consumer challenges here, and it's important to remember that 63%, when first asked this question, said nothing prevented them from buying local. But when pressed, 42% think that local food is too expensive. An important word here is think. Local food isn't necessarily always more expensive, but there's definitely a perception out there that it is. And another issue is access. 30% reported that access to where local food is sold presents some sort of difficulty for them. But that is a relatively low percent compared to the interest that we're seeing. So our takeaway from this is that Northampton consumers want local food on the table. They have the means, the motive, and the opportunity to bring a lot of local food into their households.
Awesome. So again, we had the opportunity to speak with lots of restaurateurs, and I know that there was a lot of knocking on doors to get this survey to come to fruition. But we're happy to synthesize the data of 38 restaurants who participated in our survey. That was out of 72 in total. Again, Fran mentioned earlier that there was a difficulty in gathering information from restaurant chains, but we were able to get information from delicatessens, cafes, small restaurants, fine dining restaurants. So just kind of a wide range of different restaurants in Northampton. We found that each one on average is selling 100 to 300 meals per day. And in total, these 38 restaurants are serving well over 6,000 meals per day. So if you scale that up to include the 72 other restaurants that weren't included here, there are a lot of plates of food being produced in Northampton. It's considerable. So going on to the next slide, we found that 90%, almost all of these restaurants found that local is important to clients, reflecting the interest we talked about in the consumer survey, and that it's also good for business. So that's really a two-pronged question there. It's not only is it that the clients want it, but it's also good. It's a good part of their business, and it's an important part of their business and their identity. And 80% express an interest in purchasing local food, which is fantastic. That being said, like all of the other consumers of local food in the Valley and in Northampton, they do face some barriers. That we'll go into the next slide, but the most important parts for them when buying local food or making food purchasing decisions were freshness, quality, price, and availability. And when you think about local food, freshness and quality are pretty strong right there. So the challenges that these restaurants are facing really come into play when it comes to marketing. So many of these restaurants don't have the time, or they don't put the time and energy into marketing local foods that are on the menu. So many times people walk into a restaurant and don't even know that they're eating local potatoes. They also struggle with this consumer perception of the high cost of local food and the high price. So that can be a deterrent for many customers. Seasonal availability is also a strong issue. Many people want to serve a delicious strawberry dessert in February, and that's not necessarily a reality at this point in time with our food system that we're working with. The next part is that they need regular, reliable delivery that's not a hassle for them to arrange. They need it to, the restaurant business is very fast-paced. They need a just-in-time inventory, and oftentimes, working with local farms, that part is a little bit more of a challenge to make happen. So the pullway is that Northampton restaurants are definitely into local food. They know it's important for their businesses. The thing is that if they want to bring more in, it needs to be convenient and it needs to be brought to them. The local food needs to be brought to the local, you know, local restaurant. So that's kind of our takeaway from the survey.
Okay, now moving on to the institutional survey, which is the survey that the Smith Capstone Course administered. We administered the survey to 10 institutions. We asked 13 participants to get back to us. And these were hospitals, nursing homes, educational institutions, and penal facilities. And of these institutions, 50% report feeling interested to very interested in local food. So even among institutions, at least half of them are, they have local food on their brain. 70% report serving some local food, so that's already the vast majority. 40% actively seek out local food. And all of these institutions together are serving more than 10,000 meals per day. So they are a major, major producer of plated meals in the municipality.
Something we totally did not think about. Just 10 institutions. Remember that we surveyed 27 for the restaurants, and you know, the institutions are right there at just 10 institutions. So.
We're taking a quick look at their budgets because price has been a concern for everyone, and the institutions are the same. Collectively, these institutions spend almost $800,000 on locally grown food. This is just in the last year. And the budgets definitely range. However, most institutions have budgets that are over $300,000 a year for food alone. And it's important, I think, here to highlight that the amount of local food, of money spent on local food, really varies from institution to institution, and contrary to expectation, size of food budget does not determine how much local food is being purchased. The institution that buys proportionally the most local food, they spend the most amount of their budget on it, is the institution with one of the smallest budgets out of the entire sample. And also important to look at is that it is, it's a retirement nursing facility, which means that they're serving a high-risk population that has very specific concerns. And down here we have another retirement nursing facility with a much larger food budget that is spending even less money on local food. So price means a lot, but they're clearly, some are making it work despite that. So looking at some of the institutional challenges, they require large amounts of food. They serve in bulk, they cook in bulk. As we saw earlier, they're putting out over 10,000 meals a day collectively, and that's a lot of food. The second is what we call labor in a box, that a lot of institutions work with pre-processed foods such as pre-chopped zucchini or pre-peeled squash. That's labor in a box because that means that that isn't hours that someone has to hand peel and chop hundreds of squash. That's a lot of work, and many of these institutions simply don't have the resources to devote to that. Again, like restaurants, they need regular, reliable deliveries. Most of these institutions set their menus months in advance, if not a year in advance. So when they planned a meal for a specific food, they need that food there. And the final barrier that we saw was state and federal regulations that end up often impeding local purchasing. And this could be anything from extremely strict health and safety regulations for institutions serving high-risk populations, or very specific contracts that institutions get locked into that prevent them from buying food from a number of different sources. But this was a huge challenge for many of those surveyed. But our takeaway here is really that institutions are Northampton's untapped market. There's a lot of money there, and there's a huge amount of room for expansion. Some of these institutions are only spending $5,000 a year out of their over $300,000 annual food budget on local food, and that is huge room to expand. All right, now we're going to look at the way we summarize all of these findings. First, looking at the level of interest. And what we noticed is that there are very high levels of interest in Northampton among all of the consuming players in our food system. In restaurants, 80% of managers were interested in local food, and around 70% of chefs were. And that's really important to see that we need the support of both sides, those who are buying the food and those who are cooking it, because that is a partnership. And again, in terms of institutions, 80% of institutional food directors are very interested in local food. And 60% of chefs and institutions are interested in local food as well. And then looking at the consumers, 93% feel that buying local helps the local economy. So local is very present in everyone's minds, and many people are very interested in it. And we just want to highlight briefly that in terms of consumers, we know that the Be a Local Hero campaign of CESA's has really helped keep local food in consumers' minds. When they go to the grocery store, if they see that mark, then they know. And at least, even if they don't buy it, they're thinking about it.
So also, another key part here is that we really wanted to say, you know, get an idea of the kind of money that's you know, pooled here in Northampton. So in order to get an idea of that, first we looked at the sheer number of meals that are being served. So between restaurants and institutions, we have well over 16,000 meals being served daily. I want to emphasize that this is a rock bottom number, and no, by no means represents kind of the depth or the quantity of food meals being served by those people we couldn't survey. So this is just a very minimum number, still a lot of meals. 9,900, almost 10,000 of those meals are being served by institutions alone, which harkens back to our idea that institutions really are an untapped market that we don't discuss enough, and are a fantastic place to expand for local food. And so then just looking at the number of dollars being spent here, you'll see that restaurants are spending $4.5 million on food. Institutions, $3 million. Residents, well over $4.3 million. This is these are very conservative estimates, but respondents together are spending nearly $12 million on food annually, which is incredible to think about. And again, that's just the bottom of the barrel. And really feel strongly that that local food could be a driver of our economy in Northampton. It's not something that you can send overseas. It's not something that can leave the valley. If we can tap into this market, I think there's great potential for a multiplier effect in our economy.
Now we're going to run through briefly the common barriers that we saw, because it's actually really interesting that among all four surveys, several themes kept coming up and just occurring repeatedly, and we gave six different names to them, but these appeared in almost every survey. The first is seasonal availability, and this is what can we get when? And part of this is also understanding that there is local food available in November. It's there, and but however, some people just don't understand that. Another was relationships. There's a lot of gaps between people who want to buy local food but don't know where or who to go to. Institutions who aren't sure what farmer could best supply them with, say, tomatoes or something like that. But there's a lot of instances where just introducing two people to each other would really get business going.
It's a human connection there as well. It's not just a database with information. It's a relationship. Someone there to make that bond happen.
So another was distribution, processing, and storage. Both restaurants and institutions really needed, they expressed interest in regular, reliable deliveries. So working on distribution, processing, getting things that are at least minimally processed and readily available for people, and as well as storage. If people want to work with extending the season and preserving foods, they need somewhere to put it. Another is the perceived price with local. As we saw in both the consumer and restaurant survey, there's a perception of a high price associated with local food, which might not necessarily actually be there. Another is awareness and access to information. As I stated previously, some people don't understand when local food is available, when it's in season, where to go, the fact that we have a winter farmers market, things like this that could be fairly readily remedied if we just give people a little bit more information. And finally, state and federal rules and regulations cropped up multiple times, which is, of course, not something that necessarily we're going to be able to change. Congress is particularly finicky, and I don't know if we could change that. But it's something to keep in mind, that this is a common barrier that's recurring, and this is a challenge for many people.
I'm sure that's something that's echoed in your minds as well. It's, not, we can't fix all of these barriers, but we've come up with some recommendations that will at least address them and work on them in the long term.
So my name is Adele Franks, and I am very pleased to join our Smith student colleagues in presenting recommendations based on our findings. The students went way beyond the call of duty to look for examples from other locations and other states of things that demonstrate how to revitalize or strengthen local agriculture. So we have grouped our recommendations. We're going to talk about approximately 10 recommendations. And just to go back for a second, one of the things we realized in the course of this 4 years that we've been working on this project is that Northampton is really too small of a location to focus on, that we really have to have more of a regional perspective. And so all of the recommendations that we're going to talk about tonight, we intend to be implemented in collaboration with other regional organizations such as the Pioneer Valley Planning Commission, CESA, and other agricultural commissions and others. So moving on to our recommendations, we have grouped them into three categories. One is those that are directly related to economic development, those that are very much tied to the need to share information, and those that require municipal support. So moving into economic development, we think Northampton is really poised to become a local food destination. There's just no reason not to pursue that. We have the interest, and we have a lot of restaurants. And if we do pursue this in a vigorous fashion, we think this could be a real economic driver with a ripple effect to all the other businesses in downtown Northampton. So first and foremost of our recommendations is that Northampton really needs to have a permanent farmers market. It would ideally be a publicly owned facility, or at the very least have a very long-term lease agreement. So it would be a year-round facility, so there would be plenty of indoor space, not only for farmers markets, but to serve many other purposes as well that we're going to go into in the next couple of minutes. And it could serve, you know, not only food, would primarily serve food-related activities, workshops and events, but also other types of community events could be held in this space, if it were as beautiful as this one. And clearly, we think it needs to be accessible and centrally located. And so we think that the ideal place for this would be in the Roundhouse property.
Yeah. We thought that would happen. Can speak to the Eastern Market specifically.
So looking at, this is actually a photo of Eastern Market in Detroit, and this is a wonderful example of how a permanent farmers market can have a positive effect, not only for farmers and consumers, but for an entire neighborhood. This is a market that's located in Detroit, which we all know is bankrupt and having a lot of problems. However, the neighborhood that hosts this market is rich and vibrant. This market has brought a host of restaurants all around it. It's really a booming business, not only on the Saturdays during the Tuesday markets, and it brings people in from as far as 45 minutes away. My family, I live 40 minutes away from Detroit, and we go in regularly. So it can be a huge draw and really revitalize an area, especially if it can work in Detroit, it can work in Northampton.
What's terrific too is we saw, you know, we talked about distribution quite a bit, and kind of one of those ideas, if you build it, they will come. And in Detroit, that's happened. So we see all of these distributors, all these, like, you know, small family businesses that have cropped up right around, you know, this fantastic resource. And so you've got all these businesses right there. So right at the end of the day, when I know I work at a kitchen garden farm, I put too many vegetables back on a truck to go back north up the highway. So if those could end up in a truck being sent off with a distributor to an institution, which is happening at the market here in Detroit, then that's something that could happen in Northampton as well. So you can see another example is Ithaca, New York, which is another college town with a similar size. Detroit is different from Northampton, certainly, but Ithaca is very similar. They have this this fantastic farmers market that people come from miles out of states to go to, which is something that Adele and I have discussed in meetings past. But that's something to really think about. It's just attracting people into Northampton. It's a great day trip or a weekend vacation.
So one of the things that could be housed in this permanent farmers market is a small-scale minimal food processing facility, which could peel and chop and package and freeze and store vegetables in a convenient form, so that it could be used out of season, so that mm-hmm. our restaurants and institutions could be using local produce out of season very conveniently. And
we also envisioned this as a local food community center, and all of this could be housed theoretically in a permanent farmers market structure. But at the local food community center, we could have community workshops and networking nights, both of which we're going to talk a little bit about later, as well as different activities from PD Grows and also business development workshops to really help out farmers who are looking to expand their business in various ways.
Yeah, a lot of this stuff is already happening. And you get an email and a listserv, right? You have no idea where it's going to be held. And it might be quite a drive from downtown, and this would be a fantastic way of bringing everybody into one place for all these cool activities that are going on with it, whether it's with PD Grows or CESA or, you know, a local business development, you know, organization, something like that, all in one place. So you might see a spike of, you know, community involvement in food and agriculture.
So there are a lot of ways to promote local food. And one of them would be to have sponsor a local food week in Northampton. And I'm sure you all could think of, you know, dozens of things you would include in the local food week, but these are some of the ideas that we came up with. One is, you know, have the restaurants competing with each other to produce the best menu based on local ingredients. You can even have chef competitions where they have the same ingredients and have to come up with different sounds fun to me anyway. And you know, we have local publications that could be giving awards to restaurants where the diners are voting them to be the best at providing creative menus of local food. We envision the lively food and farming film festival. There are lots of films that have food themes, as well as serious films about food and likewise about farming. There could be book groups that could sponsor readings of food-related books and hold conversations at the library. We could have food-related lectures, workshops, and all kinds of interesting demonstrations. And it could culminate in some kind of a big celebration, which could highlight farmers' products, showcase some products, hold the CSA drive. I'm envisioning music and art as well, and that would be quite a draw. You know, the Garlic and Arts Festival, which is only a couple of days in Orange, Massachusetts, draws people from all over the state of Massachusetts. And then it involves a lot of food, a lot of art, and a lot of music, and it's very successful. So,
despite the bad parking and locations.
Well, we think Northampton would be a wonderful location to have a local food week, something that really stretch out and bring people here. Now, we know from our survey that the people who are the most likely to go out of their way to buy local food are the people who are high income and high in education. And so there have been some efforts here in Northampton to make sure that we're reaching people who aren't so fortunate with giving them access to fresh, healthy local food. And that's been the so-called SNAP Times 2 program that the Tuesday Market initiated, where through private donations, people's SNAP cards have been doubled in value at the farmer's market. And the Tuesday Market has done a great job of bringing in those SNAP recipients. And it's been very, very popular. In fact, they often are on the brink of running out of money to continue the program. You know, unfortunately, the fundraising is really just a couple of people doing it, and there's no sustained effort. We would like to see the doubling of SNAP to become an existing sustainable program that we can expand and rely upon, which would require, you know, aggressive fundraising on a continual basis. We could certainly take advantage of having something like a local food week, having local restaurants donate a portion of their profits for that week to the program. We can become part of the hundreds of calls and emails that we're all getting today about Valley Gifts Day tomorrow. But mostly what this program needs is an institutional sponsor. It can't rely on two people. It just can't. It's not going to, my prediction is it's not going to be sustainable. And I don't think it could possibly grow. There have been some preliminary conversations between farmers market managers, as I understand it, and some city representatives with the United Way as an organization who could take on the program permanently. And one of our recommendations is to vigorously pursue that and build on what's already started and see whether that could really become sustainable. Another possibility is CISA is another organization dear to our hearts that could do it. Ultimately, we'd like to see this become a sustainable situation, perhaps even with an endowment, something of a sufficient magnitude that it could be housed in an account of the Community Foundation of Western Massachusetts, which has the advantage of doing all of the, has the capacity to do the administrative work, so that if United Way or CISA were running the program, they would not be burdened with the receiving the checks, dispersing the money, thanking the donors, sending out tax confirmations, all the administrative work would be done by the Community Foundation.
Okay, so one problem that came up in the farmers for restaurants as well is marketing and letting people know when local food is being sold. And we thought that working with supermarkets would be a great way. In our class's research, we discovered a group called the Flat Pioneer Valley Growers Association who is selling to many supermarkets who are then putting the produce out on the floor with no label. So consumers are buying local produce without even knowing they're buying local produce. We thought to work with supermarkets to actively label and highlight their local food could then in turn promote more purchasing of it, as we saw there's a lot of interest, and if people know it's local, they're more likely to purchase it. So we thought consistent labeling of all local food in supermarkets, as well as perhaps special sections so people know exactly where to go when they walk in the doors, they see it there. And also perhaps to work in conjunction with the local food week and really promote the products that they have there and feature them prominently, because if they stay more visible and really put out in the forefront, people will know they can buy that and that, yes, that squash they've been getting for years actually has been coming out of the valley and they can even know it.
Our prediction is that the grocery stores will get more interested in stocking local food when they see that it's actually more popular. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, certainly. So our ideas, when we spoke with all of these 10 institutions, we all sat down as a group of the Capstone students here and had lengthy conversations with food service directors and chefs. Something that came up was the issue of bringing local food to scale in an institutional setting where budgets are tight. They have strict regulations, not only from the state and from the U.S. government, but also from the corporation that runs the local facility or regarding health, if they're serving an at-risk population, contract requirements, things of that nature. They speak the same language and they share the same barriers to local food. That being said, there are some food service directors, Ken Toon over at UMass, we have Kathy Zaja and Smith, who's done some really stellar stuff. Bringing those kind of people together during a networking night so that they can communicate the struggles they're facing, some, you know, share creative solutions, brainstorm, and make connections will be a great way to move past some of these barriers and kick the door open where people are beginning to buy a little bit of local food. So we said earlier that 70% of the institutions we surveyed are buying at least some local food. we can keep that door open and increase that percentage of their food budget, that would be fantastic. We think this would be a great way to do it. We think that this type of networking night should involve workshops hosted by Massachusetts Farm to School and Farm to Institution New England, which I think Julia can speak to well because she's involved as an intern. So
these are two really wonderful nonprofits that already exist that work specifically to connect farmers with institutions. Mass Farm to School, for example, provides free technical assistance, which means matching the right farmer to the right institution and making that connection, and then helping figure out menus, helping work out delivery schedules, as well as negotiating prices that are fair to that are fair to farmers and will support them. And these are already organizations that are working together and doing really wonderful things. And to bring them into this and show institutions what resources are available to them, we think would be really helpful and encouraging.
Another piece of that is that once you've identified a farm, that would be a really good match to an institution. It could be a nursing home. If the food service director says, I'm game, and the farm says, I'm game, but they've got regulations in the way, we want to have a salaried farm-to-fork regulations liaison right there to help them hold their hand, the farmer, through those regulations. And we think that would be something that could be supported through one of our, you know, mobile food-oriented organizations. So the next piece is we saw in all of our consumer surveys this interest in mobile food. So I think, like we mentioned earlier, that could be an engine for growth in the local food economy. And in order to harness that and bring people together and create a dialogue, a strong dialogue regarding local food, we could have community workshops that would provide kind of a number of different, you know, skills and different things you can speak to specifically.
Yeah, we were thinking about, for example, cross-cultural cooking classes to really bring the community together and show them what ingredients are available and how to cook with them, as well as healthy seasonal menu planning. A barrier we found is that people don't understand what foods are available for harvest at what times of the year. So if there was a workshop there, well, this is what's growing in November, and these are the menu options. Look at these fabulous meals you can still create. That would really help people and give them that extra push to actively pursue this. As well as shopping for local food on a budget. Not everyone is a college-educated woman over 50 with a household income of $75,000 a year. And for that reason, we would really want to promote workshops that help people make ends meet and make sure that they can incorporate local food, which consumers identify as healthier and fresher, even if their budgets are a bit smaller. And this is exactly the sort of thing that would do really well in a permanent farmers market structure. Because if these reach out to all different segments of the population, and if it's in a central, walkable location that people understand is the source for this sort of knowledge, it's a lot easier to just take that couple block walk over there and find out what's going on.
Certainly. We found that we were searching for the community center in Northampton, and what we came across was the senior center, which is certainly a fantastic thing, but we really think that a community center would serve a great purpose, and this is, you know, something that could be housed there. So
now looking at the mobile marketplace, which is something Julia and I are really excited about, we thought about coming up with a program that would directly connect farmers and restaurateurs and institutional food buyers, and it would be a mobile application as well as connecting to an online platform. Because Julia, you know that farmers work with.
Yes. Right? I work at the Kitchen Garden Farm, and I swear to God, Tim and Caroline don't leave the farm or leave the farmhouse for that matter without an iPhone on them. So they do a lot of business on their iPhone. They receive orders, they update orders, they are in constant contact with their customers. The beauty of the smartphone, and Tim and Caroline are certainly not alone in this farming community of using the iPhone technology heavily, is that they don't have to be chained to a desk inside. They can be making updates out in the field and thus, you know, adds mobility and flexibility to their workday.
the same thing on the other side for chefs and restaurateurs and institutional directors. Just having an online streamlined electronic ordering program is so key. They have access to it through distribution services like FreshPoint, US Foods, even you've got Black River Produce has an online service. It's really important, and in a lot of ways, local food isn't there yet. With that piece, I think this would be a great way to facilitate more purchasing.
Yeah, and to make it more convenient for all players, because convenience is an issue. If we streamline the process, there are fewer roadblocks that come up. And we looked at possibilities for this to promote further engagement between Smith and the greater Northampton community. The Smith College Computer Science Department is chock full of student programmers who are just itching to get some practical experience. And they have all sorts of classes in maintaining databases and programming mobile apps. So that is a unique resource where a student intern could just develop a user interface. And that's step one. And a student got experience, and the city got a really wonderful program. And so that's everyone in that combination.
You might mention that some entrepreneurs have already started working on developing this kind of thing, and they're in various stages of development, and there are some parts of the state where some of these systems are actually in use. So there's something to build on. We're not really starting from nothing. Okay, so on to municipal support. We think it's very important for cities to continue to aggressively address the issues of farmland preservation and protection from dumping and vandalism, which is a difficult problem, particularly in weather scenarios. And we also think that in line with the Pioneer Valley Planning Commission's recent report on food security, in which it recommended that currently non-agricultural land be converted to agricultural production to meet future needs and future uncertainties in the valley, we would like to recommend that our city look for opportunities to bring underutilized lands into agricultural production. And the recommendations that we've made so far tonight all, to some extent, require municipal support and enthusiasm, but none more than the creation of a permanent farmers market, which could help promote agricultural tourism and boost downtown businesses as well. We think, that one, without municipal support, that one's dead on arrival, so.
It's something that's been echoed in many of the other reports that we've looked into. It's been thought through. And it's something that, just this weekend, the farmers market was moved from, if not from one place to another, from one building to another on Saturday. And even that has an effect, and it creates instability for farmers, and it also creates, a lack of consumer confidence as well that it'll be there next Saturday. It was canceled once, as we all know, right between the start and the end of the fall market and the beginning of the second, the winter market. And we really feel that it's time has come for a permanent structure.
And then finally, the doubling of SNAP benefits is something that will also require some assistance from the city. It's very unlikely to become institutionalized with a local nonprofit without some help from the city. We have too many different people involved in the farmers market management system. We really need city leadership to bring that into fruition. So, now we would like to open it up for discussion.
Certainly. Board of Assessors.
I think that
the project include a conversation with the local Board of Assessors? And the answer is no.
Okay. I think that it's worth pursuing as the project goes forward because they hold an important role in assessing the value of 60 money opportunities.
Yes.
Expecting to start a question.
Could I just repeat your comment that the Board of Assessors is important in talking about things, for example, like the value of 61A properties and things like that.
let me elaborate. I received a complaint from a farmer. I received a complaint from a farmer who has spent a lot of time and effort building a beautiful farm stand on his property. And he is, his taxes have increased because the value of his property. Down the road, his neighbor is marketing for free at the farmer's market. And he simply asked if someone would please consider local conversations about that dynamic which we set up when we structure local taxes on agricultural improvement. The second quick question I was going to ask was, did the project include, did you touch on the base of, on the topic of food waste?
We did. Who would like to comment on that?
Well, repeat the question.
Did we do anything about the problem of food waste?
That was something that we didn't cover as much. Our project is admittedly focused on food supply issues, and it is important to note that waste is a whole other half of the food system. However, there has been already some interest in next year's capstone tackling that issue.
Right.
Yeah, Paul's very interested. Paul Wetzel. We didn't really get to mention who has been a really, really big part of all of this research. We could not have done, without the research and the synthesis of the research, we could have not have done it without him. Way to conference, but he's been a really fantastic part of this whole process, and he is interested in doing a whole capstone dedicated just to waste.
If people are interested in that, then discovered that for him, it's 50% less expensive, so he spends 50% less sending it to the compost, to a farm that uses the, I don't know, New England Farmers, small New England Farmers Association or whatever, they use it, and it's way less expensive than sending it to the landfill. So, that's what I know.
Okay. More questions or comments?
So I'm Phil Corman, I'm the director of CESA. I just want to say, incredible job, really. A lot of work went into this. And a lot of things that you're thinking about sort of reinforces conversations that are going on up and down the valley and throughout New England. So you obviously have hit upon all the issues because, and you're bringing fresh energy to it. So that's really, really great. So very quickly, I'd say a couple of things. One, I think the permanent farmers market is really interesting. Maybe the next step is to see, some kind of assessment, whether it's actually possible with the population base you have. Ithaca is different than here because it clearly is the only draw in that area. Whereas here we have Greenfield, we have Amherst, we have Northampton. Amherst has talked about this idea a lot. So it doesn't mean it's not possible, You can repeat something that someone thought 5 years ago, and you might be successful with it, even though 5 years ago it couldn't move. So don't let people dissuade you, but maybe the next step, if that's the most exciting concrete thing you want to move on, it would be great to do some kind of economic analysis about it, about the population base on it. I love the idea of Northampton Local Food Week. Some pieces of this have happened in some ways. CESA does a restaurant week. Part of the challenge is choosing a time that works for the businesses. We chose end of August, mid-August, because that's when business was really slow for them. They didn't need to be highlighted at other times, nor did we do much in way of being successful in mid-August. So there's been some attempt. The double up food stamp benefits, I always go back and forth between shouldn't we be. There was a research study being completed in Hampden County by the USDA called the Healthy Incentives Project, and that was basically looking if you gave folks on food stamps 30% back when they bought produce, would they increase the amount of produce they bought? It wasn't focused on local per se, but I'm always torn a little bit about us raising money privately versus changing public policy. So, and there's maybe both need to be done. And there's also, other farmers markets that do a good job about raising money also. So we've thought about doing a regional fund. Still would like to consider it. part of the challenge is a lot of things around equity. Do you give the same amount to a farmer's market that doesn't raise as much? They may need it more. So there's a lot of things to think about that. And I think we need to keep thinking about it because clearly we don't want it to be a gourmet ghetto local food. And so what we need to do is increase the purchasing power of folks who are on food stamps so the farmers can get the price they need to get and everybody has access to the food that is grown in their community. Promoting local food in supermarkets, it's a great idea. As you know, a lot of some supermarkets, like River Valley Market, does an amazing job. Big Y is a member of the Local Hero Program. Stop and Shop is not. To me, in a supermarket, you can have incredible impact. They often say if you just have 10 people visit your local congressman or woman, you can impact that person's voting record. Well, have 10 people go visit the produce manager, and you can have a lot of impact. So we've been doing, along with Farm to School, Massachusetts Farm to School, both organizations have been highlighting two produce items a month and are continuing to do that through April. And we've been first working with the supermarkets and the local stores and then spreading it to consumers. And supermarkets are where most people buy their food. It's just true. And it's the toughest nut to crack because of the quantities that they need to buy, the distribution change where they get it, and the corporate culture. All right, I'm just going to stop talking except to say one thing. It's really neat. We issued a report this week called Eat Up and Take Action for Local Food, and you've done it already. So I'm going to pass it around. I have about 5 copies, but please return the color one. And you can get it at buylocalfood.org for free. Just download it. So great work.
Thanks, Bill. And I actually wrote to Margaret today to bring some of that new report you just did so that we can share it with this group. So thanks for doing that, too. Yes, Margaret.
I had an idea for the SPIT students that want to do the local app, which is a really cool idea. I've been working on fundraising ideas, and one thing that we know really works is whatever site you have, if you put a donate now button on the site, it might be one way to raise money for the double up food stamp benefits. Mm-hmm. So, doesn't happen too much.
Yes.
Regulations related to how food is handled if it can be served in a school. Mm-hmm. So if a local farmer has their produce out on the truck for too many hours, then it can't be sold to the school. That's my understanding. That's one small example of how the regulations can interfere with getting local food into schools and nursing homes.
As well as looking at public safety about, for example, high-risk populations can be served pasteurized eggs. That's one example of public safety concerns for certain people who serve certain foods that are highly processed in some way, as well as farmers being certified in certain agricultural practices to be able to even sell their products to certain institutions. And those are bureaucratic hoops that have to be jumped through. They're very expensive to get certified in, and involve a lot of paperwork.
And, you know, hot on the topic, obviously, is we know that, you know, and good agricultural practices are certainly an issue here.
Well, I think this is a very important point. I think this is a roadblock. I think everybody has to be aware that. I think, you know, they had a meeting, I think, at Wally Sikowski's farm this summer about this. All these things we hear about going on out west, especially on, well, that one in Colorado with the spoilage of you have no idea about the federal level what's happening. You know, they're imposing these rules. At this point, they're not imposed, but they're going to be possibly on the Northeast, where our farming footprint is entirely different. And I think everybody needs to be aware of that in their congressional delegations, and let them know, support one of these meetings if you're here, understand what's going on, because this is a big thing. The bottom line, and I've said this all along, is if a guy that wants to get into agriculture or whoever it might be, if that can't make a living at it, they're not going to do it. And everything you brought up tonight, I think there's some great ideas about the farmers market that might have to be done more on a regional scale. For example, in Northampton, one of the biggest problems is a lot of the farmland is being bought up by fellows that started small, that are getting bigger and bigger and bigger, so to try to get land that's productive in farming, it's really hard. Not because farming, you know, the bigger, a lot of these guys have found the bigger you get, the more, the little bit better, you know, profit to employ people, and that's what, it's just been a process of a long time to get to this point. But number one, the guy's gonna make a living. Farmland is a little tight, trying to get something. The idea about productive farmland in my campaign, it takes money to make farmland productive. That's a big thing. So it all plays into the fact that, just like anybody else in this room, everybody wants a job, everybody wants to make a decent living. The bottom line is that this person can make a living and can market his products, and I think this is what this is all about. We're up and on our way. But if the big thing is,
a school curriculum that would be fantastic for Northampton Public Schools, and that's something we certainly looked at, and I want to make it very clear that those workshops that we suggested are something that is inclusive to all different types of people, and it's something that we hope to draw on the whole community, and that's certainly a topic in our class
that we've discussed at length. Rebecca can speak specifically to her visit to the Northampton Public Schools.
Oh, yes, definitely. So, Haley and I visited the Northampton High School, and we spoke to the professors there, Ms. Armstrong, the health and nutrition course there, and then the one who also does culinary arts, classes. And I'm like, there is a lot of enthusiasm from students there. The health and nutrition class is a mandatory course that's offered two times, and that only focuses a little bit on nutrition, but within that course, she does focus on the importance of fresh produce and eating locally. Classes are elective, and one of the great things about those is that they have financial assistance, which allows them to offer their students the opportunity to explore new ingredients and go either harvest from their school garden or go out to town and find new ingredients that they never would have seen in their household or experienced otherwise, and then they can take it into the classroom and really experiment. But definitely one of the main ideas behind this curriculum is definitely access. Because one thing that my background and interest into is definitely working with parents to figure out ways to make meals affordable and convenient. Because I know, if you're a working parent, you're coming home and you don't have this time to make this huge meal and what I do. It's really working with parents and developing skills that will allow them to not only afford it and also bringing in knowledge about the different programs, because there are benefit programs out there. It's just knowing who to go to, how to use them. So, I don't know.
Yeah, certainly. If you're interested in reading that curriculum, I encourage you to all look online once the final report is posted towards the start of the coming year. So that's something that will definitely be included in our report and open for public to read.
Also, there are some smaller programs where school children are brought out to farms to do some gleaning, and then they cook the food and prepare it in various ways and bring it home to the families. So that's another way of introducing novel or unusual healthy fresh food to people who might not otherwise ever eat.
We have some other local programs. Within Massachusetts, one of them, Mass Holdings, forgetting the name, but yeah, in our paper, we have some other kind of models for the
Bill.
Bill White, the Virginia City Council, and I heard how the municipalities help. I'm not sure if I've heard or understand the regulations that might be serving the benefit of the municipal limitations. I don't understand if you fill me in on that. I know the assessor's part came up. And it should be noted that we don't set the criteria for assessment. The city doesn't use one. We only set the rate. The assessments are actually prescribed by state statute. We can't arbitrarily decide where we assign our values. And that's not entirely up to us.
That came up in the survey of farmers, and it was just listed as regulations. But I'm not sure that I ever understood what the regulations were. But John, you know.
The assessor's situation, the state designates certain farm things as different values. And basically, most assessors across the state accept it. One of the biggest problems has been up in South Deerfield the last few years, where there's been a few exceptional sales of land. So the assessors has gone and up the rates far beyond the scope of what the state has set. So I think that's where the biggest problem is. And other farming communities are concerned about this as a trend that may happen.
basically it's the values of the assessors are putting on the land, even though the state designates pasture land as this, crop land as this, you know, hay field or something else.
I think the other regulation piece, though, that a lot of people were speaking about was land use, you know, and zoning, and what, you know, what you can use your land for, who can't, what comes in the bundle of rights that, you know, go along with your land, and who some people would like to see some more flexibility in terms of land use, and maybe that's something that was wrapped into the regulation piece when it comes to the municipality itself.
Anything specifically? I mean, John asked you a powerful point on the extent to which you influence on at least keeping the assessor.
In the case of point out, for example, Northampton, for example, you can't apply for Chapter 61A classification for your land unless you have 5 contiguous acres. Okay, now what's happening is, and I can see it in this room, I see it as the Ag Commission itself, is that in the Northeast, the is smaller farms. So, again, you're going to take away from your tax rolls by going to 61A and less than 5 acres. But on the other hand, if you get some tax relief and you can get some money flowing through produce and maybe do something, for example, with generating place for people to have a common farm as well. That little thing alone might help, you know. And the other thing is to just what John said, keep aware of what's going on in South Deerfield, because there's no reason in the world why you couldn't raise assessment on 61A land.
One of the things we saw in the impact of farmers is the sanitization of a lot of farms, where a lot of farmers do.
Actually downward. I mean, there's less farmland being farmed now in the state than it was 10 years ago, but there's like 200 more farms. So, I mean, do the math. They're getting smaller.
There wasn't a lot of discussion of husband. And I you know, we lost virtually every dairy farm in the public part of the state. And in relatively quick short order. I recognize the intensity use in land in dairy processing, associated costs, and all of that, but clearly there is a market for us, the local dairy production, meat production, that would probably give a broader spectrum of options for local purchasers. Is there something a municipality can do to promote that? I mean, this is basically my framework. I don't have the authority beyond municipal governments other than just be like you and real against the environmental system that we're struggling with. But we do have some influence, and I need to know somewhat more specifically how we can not only help promote, which I heard about, but also how we can also facilitate.
And I think a lot of the regulations are not city regulations.
Right, well, I understand.
There are ways that the city has to respond to state and federal regulations, which is awful.
Right, I mean,
yeah.
Right now there's a much bigger meat market for local meat in the area than there is production. Throttle point is where it's processed. I mean, there's very few processing points because everything's generated right now through the USDA, the Farm Bureau and some other agencies are trying to get it so that the state has more control over this, so that the process will be more streamlined and they'll be able to open up more ways to process the local meat so that it'll be available to the people. Because right now it's going to Vermont, it's going to New Hampshire, it's going to Rhode Island. And I've talked to people that said, you know, I used to be able to say, I'm going to send up something in a couple of weeks, no problem. Now they got to schedule a year ahead because that's how far the backup is. So, I mean, that's one of the biggest problems is processing the product that they want.
Didn't they have
more on
that?
Yeah, but that's,
they have a mobile, that's all. Yeah, they have a mobile slaughtering house as well. There's actually a great CISA report on this. Fantastic. And if you would like to see the, you know, the recommendations that you even have there in the study you've done, we read that study and looked at it, and we were struggling in our class considerably with the issue of meat. We talked about it at length, and we decided that we didn't think we were all that prepared to take on that problem-solving process. That being said, it doesn't mean that there aren't steps to be taken. And I encourage you to read CESA's report regarding meat in the valley, and certainly regarding, you know, distribution or slaughtering, really, you know, and processing and distribution. That is, are all issues.
And I can add that from our surveys, there was a lot of interest, in particular, in meat.
Yes.
They wanted more fresh local meat.
Yes. And the price was an issue there as well.
And there is, Sutter's is opening up in a month in downtown Northampton on King Street, and they're sourcing local meat, and local farmers are sending most of their animals to Athol, and they'll pick it up, you know, after it's been killed, and they'll be making the cuts on it. So we'll see how that the model goes.
A lot of the collapse of the local dairy farm is based on regional or national levels of there's price supports, governmental price supports that started back in the 30s in the Depression to try to maintain some kind of a sense to give and a lot of this there was a Northeast Dairy Compact that collapsed because we just didn't have the votes.
Federal government can do that.
Pardon?
The federal government had something in the ending of that. Right. Yeah.
We didn't have the votes to counteract it.
Right.
You see, our congressional delegation didn't have in the Northeast didn't have the power to. But it's just so ironic because we've got a heavy population concentration here on the East Coast and in the Northeast, and it just seems to me that as the price of fuel goes higher and higher and higher, this whole meeting, everybody here tonight realizes that. I think that as time goes on, we're going to need more access to local food just to protect ourselves. And this is what the more people that are aware of this, the more educated we can get on this, the more we can tell our congressmen about this and push them.
Well, one of the big things right now is the farm bill not being passed. I mean, that may be a collapse of the dairy price, and then maybe a spike in milk anyway, because that's basically determined of how much it costs to make cheese in Wisconsin determines the price of milk for the country.
Exactly.
So that's why, you know, Wisconsin is a little bit different doing dairy than it is here in New England. So
very complex, very complicated situations, not very easily resolved.
And in the short term, we'd love to see more land protected so that in the future when we move to make substantive change in those types of, you know, harder issues, that the land's still there. That's really key, that the land is still there and there is someone there interested in farming it.
Well, you know that, particularly through the Office of Planning and Sustainability, that we've done a very aggressive campaign of retaining all the arable land in the valley so it doesn't go to development and housing intensity.
Exactly.
But, I think I don't think you'll find much pushback from on the municipal side as far as his fellow friends, the former city councilor, and former conscience of the city council. And we are predisposed to do this. I need to have, at least myself, and I'm sure the mayor as well, need to have a better understanding of what. I want to know what impediments we set up, and I think I've got a sense of that now on some level. And we certainly have a sense of what the recommendations are. And you know, Phil actually laid out some of the challenges for some of those. But that's okay, because we don't step on ideas. We massage them.
I want to say that I think we should probably kind of close this at around 9. I mean, that was kind of what we had in mind. So maybe one or two more questions, maybe one more question, or comment. Jerry?
I was president of the Ward 3 Neighborhood Association. Ward 3 includes the Meadows. And over the years, I've had calls from a number of people, particularly from younger folks, who wanted to get into farming and wanted to know if there was any land available for farming. I had no idea where to send them. I don't know if there's any registry. I don't know if there's any, you know, website where people who have land to rent put it up on a website. Whether there's, if it is, it's a well-kept secret. and it needs to be publicized because there are young people out there. The average age of our farmers is increasing. There's a lot of young people want to get into it, but they don't know how to access land, as Mr. Jeske was saying. That's a very tough issue. And I think more work needs to be done on making sure that people who want to get into it can get land.
Did you want to comment on that, Phil?
Basically, you can call CESA. You can call a lot of groups, and we can give them the information. There's a lot of referrals for that. There's a beginning farmers network statewide. So there are places to go to see if there's land available. You can start with us if you want.
There is a website called NewEnglandFarmLandFinder.org, which is a product of the other linking organizations in all six states. And it's picking up steam, and it's I think it would be very useful.
Yeah, thank you all for coming, and I want to express the fact that us 10 students, as well as Adele and Fran and some others here who have been very involved in the Keep Farming Initiative, are here. If you'd like to ask questions specifically to any one of the groups, we invite you to do so. We'll be here. We're not leaving Northampton until May. So please reach out to us. And if you have a bright idea or you have something you want to move forward with, we have a lot of energy here and a lot of dedication, and we've put our heart and soul into this, as has every other player in this. And it's been a joy and truly special to collaborate with each group in the Keep Farming Initiative. And we so appreciate all of your hard work. I look forward to moving forward with these recommendations.
I want to add a word to not only a thanks for all of you, but I've been sort of listening to all of this tonight, and it seems to me that a lot of what we've said is already known. We've already sort of aware of the problems, and we're aware of a lot of the possibilities. I think one of the things this group has done is to put some numbers on that, which is always a helpful thing to do, it seems to me. But we know that we will go forward inch by inch, that there will be some progress here and step back here, and there will always be problems. If there weren't problems, it would be done. But when I try to step back and take a much longer view, I see some trends that I think probably most of you see too. One of them is I've noticed that the Christmas shopping this year is almost all online. A huge amount of it is online. Just in the last very few years, we have become such an outsourcing economy, such a dot-com economy. And that has so many implications for small towns and small cities like us, because what we have to concentrate on to be what we want to be is what cannot be outsourced. And when I look at that in terms of Northampton, I see an incredibly beautiful environment. We live in a wonderful place that has rich soils. Even though we've lost some of that farmland, there's still a good deal of it here, and we may be able to get some more if we keep working on it. We have a responsive city government. Mm-hmm. Not every place can vouch for that. We have a good arts community that's local, that you can build on and interact. And this whole local food thing can be a real driver in this overall community effort to bring our lives home again and to work with all these people in the community who are so engaged and so eager to have an accessible and democratic and homegrown culture here. So I'm very hopeful, and I hope you are too.